Good evening. This is Strange Love, and I'm your host, Cami Chaos. Welcome, babies. Good evening, and welcome to Strange Love Live Tech Edition. I'm your host, Cami Chaos, and as always, I'm joined by Dr. Normal.
Hello.
This evening's guests are here to talk to us about the Portland Creative Conference. Or is it the Oregon Creative? It's Portland Creative Conference. We've got Steve Galen and Tad Lukasik.
Yes, thank you.
Welcome, guys.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
So before we get into any of the nitty-gritty, the planning and what's going to go on with the conference, I want you to talk to me a little bit about the history of it, because this is, what, 13 years, 12 years?
Yeah, it ran for 12 in the original run, and then it was dark for 7, and it came back in 2008, so this will be the second year back after that hiatus. So the conference started in the late 80s. Will Vinton and some other folks, Michael Carter, who's a founder of one of the big recording studios that ran here through the 80s and 90s, and Bob Zurcher, who was at Technifilm Labs, a bunch of folks like that, leaders in the creative industries here, got together. And we're trying to think of ways to help put Portland on the map for specifically film, television, and advertising. So get more presence on the national map, get more producers aware of Portland as a location and source for talent. So they were thinking about ways to do that. Came up with this idea of a conference.
And so how did those first years go? I mean, what was the first year like? Was it kind of, did it start off small and slow, or did they just jump right in? And
yeah, so I joined as a volunteer in the second year, so I wasn't quite there for the very first year. It definitely was like a lot of conferences where they're growing in both audience size and quality of speakers and sponsors. So it was definitely a grassroots effort and a very volunteer, community-driven effort by the, mostly again, film, television, and advertising industries here in Portland at the time. And just the idea of kind of helping to brand Portland as a creative center. And that's, I think, what's interesting about looking at the history and kind of where Portland's at now. The Creative Conference sort of looped in Vera Katz into the whole, when she was mayor at the time, into the whole creative services discussion. So it was really kind of the, in some ways, not the main driver, but a driver and a contributor to this idea of Portland as a creative center that we all think of now. So it's starting, their first conference was 1990, so that was the, and it went to 2001, so that was the initial run.
So who were some of the early speakers, some of the early attractions for the conference?
Sure. I mean, I think, you know, it's like last year we started local to keep some of the costs down. So, of course, Dan Wyden was, you know, he's back this year, of course, but he was one of the early speakers. Then people would sort of just call in favors and bring in. Rick Baker was the makeup artist who was, you know, at the top of his field for many years and typically won the Academy Award for makeup and film. He was an early speaker. So it was basically about our local contacts making connections to their to people in mostly LA or New York that they knew. So a lot of behind the scenes talent, behind the camera talent, if you will, as well as some in front of the camera talent. So it's a good mix.
So isn't conference planning in general just about calling in a lot of favors and getting people who know people? Because I don't see how a conference could ever get, especially one of any size, could get pulled off without that, without a lot of handshakes and smiling.
And this year especially, and last year, it's been such a strong community effort to get this back. Steve was the architect of the return, so to speak, last year. And you know, to do that with the sponsors in the community, and especially in the economic conditions we're having, it's just been a tremendous effort for everybody. And yes, a lot of favors, you know, that we've pulled in to do that, and handshakes with folks. Again, as we rebuild that foundation for the conference, you know, it takes a community to do that.
Yeah, so absolutely.
And very exciting.
And you're right. At first, that is a lot of it. And who do we know? But the nice thing is something like that progresses. And I've got another conference that's been running for 6 years. And after, let's say, the first 3 or 4 years, you do start to get some people that want to talk at the event if it has a good reputation. So we started to experience prior years speakers having such a good time in Portland, and we really focused on that speaker word of mouth after the event, that they would go back into their communities, film, television, advertising, and then I basically later came in to add interactive. those people went back and told their colleagues about the conference. And so we did start getting some calls about year four about, hey, I heard about this conference. You know, this is what I do. Maybe I could come up there and or over there and talk. So it did pick up steam that way. But you're right. At first, it's in like the reboot last year, it does take those favors.
Yeah, the brand is very strong. You know, the brand that has been developed during that initial run. You know, and that helps a lot because most folks in the film ad and those core ones really understand what it's about. And they remember that and they want to be part of that. So it's a very, very strong brand.
What put the stop to the conference originally?
So it was three things. 9/11 was primary, so the conference was 9/14 that year. And the second factor was the same group of people generally had been together volunteering, producing the event year after year. So there's a little bit of, that was a board of directors, a little bit of board burnout. And then the third factor was there had been a change in leadership of the executive director. So the first executive director for 11 years was CJ Glazer, and she was the perfect person to manage all the egos on the board and then the sponsors
and
the speakers.
A delicate balance.
It's a very difficult thing. And so she just thought 10 years was enough. It's a very amicable parting with the board, and the board did a search for a new executive director. Looked good on paper and the interviews, but the new person did not know how to communicate with the board. So all these factors happening together, I remember very vividly we had a meeting. I don't know how we pulled it together, but we had a board meeting somewhere between 9/11 and 9/14. I don't know how we did it, but I think it was 9/12, and called an emergency board meeting. And it was really literally one of these conversations of, if we cancel the event, then the terrorists win.
There were a lot of conversations like that at the time.
And so we were determined not to cancel, but clearly we could not have the event 3 days from then, so we postponed it. And the new executive director was to go out and find a new venue. And she did that. It was a great venue. It was the Nike Tiger Woods Conference Center, and we were going to do it October 3rd, so about a month. And what she didn't communicate to the board was the cost differentiation, and that cost differential, that delta, in essence, sunk the financial position of the organization.
And if I might add, coming in from the outside, I attended many of the conferences back in the day, but I wasn't as involved as Steve was. But looking at it now, I think there are some subtleties of that era, you know, the cash-rich 90s that... that the conference wasn't truly designed to work in a recession.
Yeah.
Okay, and so one of the things that we're trying to do is to, when we rebuild that foundation and build it on bedrock and make sure that it's designed to run through all economic cycles, okay, including the one of 2001 and the one that's today.
So that when we start to see it growth in our economy, the swell.
Yes, if it works now, it will work. It will work through any cycle, and that's what we wanted to do, and we've been very successful in doing so.
In fact, the Creative Conference is responsible for that because I was on the board for 6 years, so I did marketing for two and sponsorship for two and program for two. So that's how I learned how to do conferences. And because we didn't make it out of that financial situation, the conference ended and we were in this big hole, I decided then and there that if I ever did a conference, it was never going to spend more money than it had in sponsorship. So you didn't rely on ticket sales too, because of course our ticket sales were down. And so that was a key lesson, and that's how we're operating the conference now.
That's a good thing to take away. Never spend more money than you have in sponsorship.
Yeah, it makes sense.
It does.
About it, but not everybody operates that way.
So when you guys made the decision to bring it back, how long was the gap?
It was, 7 years.
7 years.
2001 to 2008.
And what was the driving factor to bring it back?
And
what's the difference aside from the more solid foundation?
Yeah, so there's two. Well, so the first question, I just missed it. And I wanted it to come back, and I was producing conferences full time at that time. So that was my full time gig. Most of my own revenue to my company was in producing conferences. So I knew the formula, and I knew the people that did it before, and I knew who could help make it happen now. And I was working on this vision of what I call the September event cluster for Portland, which has the potential, we think, to be Portland's answer to South by Southwest. So I, in 2007, launched a conference called Inverge, the Interactive Convergence Conference, and I partnered with the Time-Based Art Festival and Music Fest Northwest to create this business plus culture experience, mm-hmm. and we bundled tickets. And so the second year into that, 2008, I wanted to add the creative conference to that cluster because I knew, I felt like it was going to take off, and I wanted the creative conference to be part of it. So that's what I, that's why I wanted to bring it back. So it was just a matter of kind of reaching out to the old network and some new network to call in the favors, just like what you said, including personal contributions. I mean, frankly, people in the old board of directors gave money, and anywhere from $100 to $1,000 a person to help kick that off. So it was a true community effort.
Yeah, absolutely.
So now you've got it back. Mm-hmm. What's the big difference?
So one of the things so it used to be film, television, advertising thematically, mm-hmm. and I came in with a few other people and added interactive. Mm-hmm. So we got game designers.
Which is huge.
Yeah, right. And this was like 1993. So it's still pretty, but you know, so we had some game designers. We had the gal who created the Webby Awards. She was a speaker one year. So we got interactive, but we kept adding these commas. And when I got the group back together, I said, I think it should be more about broader creative industry. You know, we should include product design, and we should include architecture and art, and but we can't keep adding commas, you know. So we just said, let's just have it be about creative industries, and so that was a difference content-wise, mm-hmm. and who we were targeting for our audience. So that was.
Yeah, we were up to about 13 or 14 commas.
too many commas. So that's really one of the major thematically. It's been expanded quite a bit to include all creative industries. So.
Who's I don't want to say the headliner, but what the speaker that people would be most looking forward to this year? Yeah. Who are you most looking forward to this
year? Sure. Well, our marquee speaker, if you will, we're still budget-wise sticking local because mm-hmm. you like to, if you're bringing somebody in from out of town, you like to pay airfare and hotel at least. So we're, you know, managing that budget. We're like we did last year, we're still focused on local folks, and obviously there's a rich pool of talent to draw
Portland
from.
Portland loves to see Portland people succeed.
So the first speaker we confirmed was Dan Wyden, just mm-hmm. to bring him back, and it's kind of a godfather of creativity in Portland. So that's one that I think will draw a lot of people. And then what typically happens, like with any conference, you have the people that people pay for, and then you have the people that actually, and Dan could be one of those, but you have people who you had lower expectations of, and they knock it out of the park as far as their presentation and their connection mm-hmm. to the audience and how they articulate, in this case, their creative process. So there's always surprises like that. So people that I don't know. This year, Tad had, because I had taken on a different responsibility, during the daytime of my life, I needed to find somebody to take over as producer, and so that's where I... and had worked with Tad through Oregon Creative Industries and thought he'd be a perfect person to take that over this year. So I'm not as connected to a lot of the speakers this year after Dan as Tad is.
Yeah, so we have a
Bill. I thought you called him Dan. And, we talked about this earlier.
So we have Bill Oakley from Simpsons fame. Mm-hmm. We think he's drawn. There's Amek. He's the, if I get this right, the Thinking Man's poster artist. Very well known there. We have a designer, local designer, who's done some great work, Jen Jaco. Mm-hmm. On Your Feet is there, and an author.
An improv group.
And Larry Brooks, who's a best-selling author, former principal of CMD, who's on board on the keynote roster. Mm-hmm. So it's a pretty dynamic representation of the creative industries right now, and originally with Dan as being the walking, foundation of that. So,
is it a one-track conference or?
Yeah, it is one track, and that stays, again, that's very similar or exactly what it was before. And so I liked that. I mean, part of the value for the creative conference, I came to, one of the challenges was how to describe the experience to people in marketing copy. what's our elevator pitch? And the challenge is that you, because you're wondering, well, I'm in this industry. I'm in architecture. Mm-hmm. Why should I go hear somebody from film or advertising or interior design or poster design? Yeah. And And because it's hard to describe until you've been there and experienced it. And so that single track is part of the experience. And so it's kind of staying there and not like, oh, I'll see that person, then I'll go take a break and then I'll see that person. It's see everybody and watch it serially. Because I call it a brain vacation. Mm-hmm. Your brain actually starts to make new connections. I think it's just purely new synapse connections that haven't been made for a long time or ever. As you hear people describe their creative process in a different industry, because it's like, oh yeah, because the process, you know, there's no,
even if the product or the product industry is different,
it's different. The process we can all find some touch points in the process. So it starts to you're thinking about your own work while you're listening to someone in a different field, but you start to think of your own work in a completely fresh and new way, and it's very motivating and it's inspiring, and that's hard to describe in a tagline. And so that's been part of the challenge. But that serial track, to get back to answering your question, is a key to that, I think.
So let me ask, when you're describing the conference to an investor or a sponsor, is the way you describe it different than you would describe it to someone who might attend?
Yeah, because you're to the sponsor's interested in the audience and what's the makeup of the audience. Mm-hmm. What's their industry and what's their role within that industry. So to a, something you want to chime in there,
yeah, just
to
go ahead. What the reach is, what the audience reach is, mm-hmm. You know,
okay.
What
that's good.
And I think that's a term that we all use, you know, how many, who is it, you know, your audience truly is.
Mm-hmm. Because they're looking to connect to prospective customers, you know. And there's definitely some sponsors who are doing it because they believe in what the conference is about. They believe in supporting regional creative industries. Then there's sponsors that do it because they're trying to reach an audience of potential customers or repeat customers.
Yeah, and again, the sponsors this year, again, have understand the importance of that brand, you know, and the strength of representing our creative industries, you know, globally.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's really kind of, the conference has been kind of a showcase for that over the years, you know, and so most of the businesses, you know, have come together, again, as a community to do that, you know, so it's kind of an interesting aspect for it. And this year has been very different than most, you know, from what I understand.
Yeah, so the sponsors you're selling the audience, to the audience you're selling the speakers and the experience.
Yeah. So let's get just kind of the cold hard facts, website, dates, location, etc.,
sure.
Cost,
yeah,
for attendance.
Ahead.
The website is www.createcon.com.
With an 8, number 8.
Yep. Number 8.
Create8.
Yes.
Con.com.
The date is September 12th, 2009, at the Newmark Theater. All right. Time frame is 10 to 5. There is a wrap party, we call it, from 5 to 7,
mm-hmm.
You know, afterwards. And let's see, what else did you ask me on that one?
Price point.
Oh, price point. To the public, the price point is $99, but we have a special revenue share this year. If you go with one of our revenue share partners, you get immediate 25% off of that. Again, a very strong community-based program this year.
So associations like AIGA, AMA, Portland Ad Federation, and other groups like
AIGA. Pretty much the creative industries, if you loop all associations here, they land in about 14 vertical categories.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and those associations are our main revenue share partners for that. Again, a stakeholder from the community to help the conference.
And it's helping them.
And it helps them with membership and such. So we really thought that through to kind of get the most benefit to everybody on that one.
So they offer for the association, they offer a membership, a discount to their membership. So there's a membership benefit, and then they get a share of the revenue that they refer for people to enter that discount code. So it's benefiting the association financially and from a member benefits standpoint, which is always a key to associations, is the more benefits you can obviously give your members, the more they'll be prone to renew when that comes up.
We love strong associations. Strong associations make for great creative, you know, industries. Great creative.
So what are the events on the other side? Because you've got the bundle still of different events.
So the bundle came unraveled a bit this year.
Oh, okay.
Just to be honest, there's a couple things that happened. I had to postpone Inverge until next year, so Inverge is not happening this year. And the Time-Based Art Festival moved earlier, and the Music Fest Northwest moved later. And that, you know, I still need to get back in touch and talk to those folks about that. But they, it does still overlap the Time-Based Art Festival, mm-hmm. and the PICA, the Portland Institute for Contemporary Art, mm-hmm. is a partner, mm-hmm. But we are not bundling the experience like we did last 2 years. So that's a bit different. So I think that idea is still alive, but we'll have to kind of regroup on that.
Get everybody on their feet. Yeah.
The Music Fest Northwest comes in, I think, the 16th through the 19th this year, if I remember right.
It's not too far off. It's still kind of a cluster. It's just not all aligned like they were before. And this year, frankly, everybody in that business, like a lot of businesses, have been thrown for a loop. Mm-hmm. I mean, so there's been a lot of jockeying around, you know, canceling or postponing or reshuffling. Yeah. Of course, sponsorships have been more difficult. So it's been a tough year for the event industry as well as other industries.
So do you want to talk now a little bit about some of the people and companies behind the scenes, OCI, and what was the other...
Keeping the Beat. The fiscal aid. Yeah, so I'll talk about Keeping the Beat,
okay.
And then you talk about Oregon Creative Industries.
Sure.
So the Creative Conference, in its first incarnation, was a nonprofit, a 501c3, that was governed by a board of directors and had, as I mentioned, a executive director on staff. That's a bit of work to start something like that up. Mm-hmm. And so when we started it, we consulted with the attorney who was our prior providing pro bono legal counsel to the conference. And we got the group together. It's April of 2008, when we first got the group together to start that on the path for September 2008 launch. And he said, well, why don't you? I said, I think this should be a nonprofit again. It's a community-based effort. And he said, well, why don't you just find a fiscal agent, which is just another nonprofit that your project, that could be a project of that fits thematically and mission-wise in mm-hmm. with that nonprofit. And that's a lot less paperwork. It's a lot lower cost. And so I'm like, okay. And I actually realized then, I don't know why I hadn't connected these dots, but I already had one. It's called Keeping the Beat, which I founded in 2007 as a result of a music festival that I produced that was raising money for school music programs in Oregon in mm-hmm. different parts of mostly Santa Ana Canyon and Salem area.
And that is keepingthebeat.org?
Keepingthebeat.org, right. So Keeping the Beat, I had already structured as a 501c3. There's a board of directors in place. There's an event. So it's already an events-based fundraiser for the arts. Mm-hmm. And so I thought, well, let's just bring the Creative Conference under that. It saved a lot of administrative overhead. There was already a little bit of seed money, a bank account, a reporting to the IRS. And so it was just a perfect fit, because now the conference not only is just putting on an experience for the community, but is raising money for arts education. So creating that cycle.
Yeah.
And so last year we did give 2 grants to arts programs out of the Creative Conference, which is, for the first year, we felt pretty good about having enough net left over to do that. So that's so it's a nonprofit event, and the fiscal nonprofit agent is Keeping the Beat, and the money proceeds will go to arts education in Oregon.
Good.
And so we can talk more about that later.
That's very good.
Yeah, and the alignment in the community has been wonderful too, because OCI has a vision, you know, for the creative economy to network, promote, and advocate for that.
Mm-hmm.
And you get these three pieces together, and it seemed like a natural fit for us to work together on the conference. Because there's a promotion element there,
mm-hmm.
you know, we've got that in place.
So you might just say Oregon, OCI, Oregon Creative Industries.
Yeah, OCI stands for Oregon Creative Industries.
OregonCreative.org.
OregonCreative.org.
And so we've got together, and in a traditional model, it's pretty great, because Keeping the Beat is the entity holder for the conference. You've got all the stakeholders, which are the associations of what we brought in, you know, to build that foundation we were talking about earlier, you mm-hmm. know, that will last through all cycles. Then you have OCI, whose role is really just organization and project management for that. You know, OCI as a group, you know, is made up of all those creative industries verticals. And so, again, a very natural fit with all of that in the mission of Keeping the Beat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we tie in the Regional Creative Action Plan and the folks from CAN, you know, and all those other folks that are part of the whole creative ecosystem,
mm-hmm.
Which is really nonprofit and profit.
Mm-hmm.
So again, very, very well researched, as Steve and I have spent, you know, a little bit of time on that one,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
vetting this all out and putting it all together. So OCI is a wonderful, like I said, group for that, and said lots of exciting things for us to look forward to there. So.
We've got a couple minutes left, so I was curious. This isn't strictly about the conference, but with the economy, obviously the economy hit the conference hard. I wonder, you see a lot of negative reflection from the economy in all sorts of industries, and it looks like the creative industry to some people is unnecessary. I don't think it's unnecessary. I think that creativity in its many forms, film, architecture, interactive, and so on and so forth, is very important, and people maybe need a little bit of spark in their life, especially when things are tough. But has it affected the community?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean,
yeah, and to, on your earlier point, you know, the creative economy, we are the innovation, the ideas that drive every other industry, right? America's for the Arts, for example, will say that, the high octane fuel. I won't give you my economic road trip story because Sam Adams and all those guys have already heard this a couple times, and we'll catch up that maybe in the after talk. But basically, of all those industries, no matter what you're in, it's creativity, creative intellectual property, and ideas, and that's what drives all industries. You have to have the ideas, and that's where the creative side comes in. Now, we as a cluster, you know, are as big as manufacturing, tourism, forestry products, and all that in the state, but we don't know it because we've lost our organizing entity.
There's been no voice.
There's no grouping
for that.
But on a statewide level, this is coming, and so creative industries is going to be one of those verticals that are as impactful for us here in our region as those other ones. You know, and so it's a very, very big reach, and again, it all ties into to the conference and the community and all that. So does that help? I think that.
Yeah, I think it kind of reconfirmed. Yeah. It hits everybody, but without the creative industry, you don't have the rest of it.
Well, creative industries, if you think about it, is one of the few industries that's creating new product instead of recycling and turning existing material into something else, like a shoe. Nothing wrong with creating shoes, but it's...
I like shoes.
But you know, creative industries, one of the unique things is they're creating products from nothing. So they're creating new value for the economy, brand new value. So that's... And part of what we're trying to do in representing the cluster, again, it's not that it's not already there. It's just there, but there's no one voice and seat at the table, and like at the state and local level. So that's what we've seen.
Yeah. And we have one of our big case studies out of the UK, which is the DCMS. And basically, they've gone through all their commitments, and their number one commitment out of this huge national resource pool that they've had for years and years is that every child deserves a creative education. And that's part of the thing that relates our whole ecosystem for that, because with that comes the creativity to go in and develop many of these ideas that all of our other industries need to, you know, to come to fruition. You know? So it's, like I said, very, very tied together that way.
It's important that starts early.
Yes.
Yeah. So that's really like that flow back into education and supporting that.
All right. Thank you guys so much for joining us. We'll be back soon with After Hours, and we'll talk with you in a few minutes.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Thanks for having us.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Thank you.